So the first step in this project will be to create the queries and the custom database objects required to accomplish these. Let's begin by using PySQL Client to connect to the NewGreen database. To keep everything organized nicely, let's create a catalog for the guided project. We'll right-click on Catalog, Create Catalog, and call it Guided Project. Now let's create two schemas, one called SSIS, one called SSRS. Now, let's create some of our custom database objects so that we can get the queries written that we need to store the data in the SQL server. Let's right-click on the SSIS schema and create template-specific data model. In our data export, let's grab data for the boilers, compressors, pumps, and heaters. We'll start with the boilers. We'll get an element view so that we can grab things like the plant name as well as the process name. As we build out these custom database objects, let's open up PySystem Explorer so we can follow along by looking at the AF hierarchy. We'll drill down to an example element under Houston, Cracking Process, Equipment, Boiler 210. For each of these elements, I'm interested in storing 15-minute intervals for the process feed rate value. Here we see it for the boiler, and if we move to a heater element, we can see the same value. And finally, pumps have this value as well. When I later access the data on a SQL server, I'd like to be able to slice by either location or process type, so let's make sure those values are in the results set as well. Let's go back to PySQL Commander and build the queries. We'll start with an element view, so we can get things like the asset name, plant name, and process name. We'll uncheck error, unit of measure, and timestamp, since these are just static values. We'll next do a get sampled values so that we can return process feed rate, and we'll uncheck error and UOM since we don't want to store those in the SQL database. We'll click Next and execute the query. We expand out the views and the table value functions, we see the two that we just created. Let's query them and make sure that they have the data that we're looking for. We'll right-click on the table value function and execute predefined query, and we'll replace the first part of the query with our view so that we can get the extra data that we want. We don't need the template since the guidedproject.ssis.boilerView that we're using is already filtered by boiler type. The default settings for this is a 1-hour time step, so let's change that to 15 minutes. And we'll click execute. We see we have over 1,500 rows, which makes sense given the amount of data that we're looking for. Now let's filter down the select statement to just the data that we want to store in the SQL server. And we'll execute the query. Great. Now we see we start off with the B555 element. We have the plant name, the process name, and we have every 15 minutes the process feed rate value. If we scroll down, we should see the other elements as well. Here we see a change from B765 to B125. We also see that we have both Houston and Little Rock elements, and we also have extruding plant and distilling plant elements. Now, the boiler is only one thing that we're interested in, so let's continue and make this for the other three element types. Now, I could go through and create the other three views and other three table value functions by using the wizard and selecting compressor, then heater, then pump, but I'm instead going to create these other three by using the scripting. Let me right-click on this boiler, go to Scripts, Create View, New Query Window, and I'll change boiler to heater. I'll execute the query, and repeat this for compressor and pump. I'll refresh my views and confirm that they're all there. Now let's repeat the process for the get sample values. Change this to compressor, as well as this. We'll execute it, and we'll repeat the process for pump and heater. Now let's refresh these and confirm they're created. And let's execute them to test that they work. Great. Now we're going to be doing 4 different writes to the SQL Server as part of our SSIS package, so let's create those views now, just to make sure that everything is as clean as possible within the queries within the SSIS package. So we'll go back to our original query. And we'll save this as a view. And we'll do the same thing for the compressors, pumps, and heaters. Great, let's refresh our views and confirm they're created. And let's run the queries. Great, our boilers list returns what we want, as does the compressor list, the heater list, and the pump list. Now, as part of the SSIS package, we would like to write data back to the Pi server to validate that the SSIS package completed successfully. Since the RTQP engine is read-only, we'll need to use PyOLDB provider for this. Let's make a connection to our Pi server using PyOLDB provider and create the tag that we need. We'll close out the query windows, and we'll open up the query compendium. Let's look at point database statements. We want to write a value of success to this tag every time the SSIS package completes, so we'll need to make it a string tag. So let's take this statement and copy it to a new query window. We'll name it SSIS package tracker, and we'll have it of type string. Let's execute the query to create the tag. Great, point was successfully created. Now let's go back to the query compendium and see how to write a value to it. Let's take this query and copy it to the original query window. We'll remove the questionable flag, and we'll put in the new name of the tag, a time of now, and a value of test. Let's execute this, and then let's confirm that it worked. We'll again go to the query compendium and grab one of the queries that queries the values for a tag, and let's copy it to the original query window as well. We'll change it to use our tag name, and we'll execute this. We can see originally it had a value, a point created, and now it has the value of test that we wrote. Great, so this query now works if we ever want to write a value to this tag. Let's save this query file so we can use it again when we're making our SSIS package. Finally, let's create our queries for SSRS. Close out these query windows, as well as the query compendium. In the SSRS report, we want to be able to specify a plant name and have a list of all the elements separated by template. So let's create template-specific data models, starting off with boiler. I'll create an element view that supplies the plant name. That way we can filter by it. And we'll get rid of timestamp, unit of measure, and error, since we're not interested in those for this value. We'll create a summaries so that we can look at the fuel gas flow and look at the minimum, maximum, average, and total across the last 24 hours. We'll do total, average, minimum, and maximum. We'll uncheck those boxes as well. Finally, we're going to want to put everything together into one query for all 4 of the element types. So in order to make sure the column names match, we're going to change the value of the column name right here using utility. This will be consistent across all template types. Great. Now let's execute the query. I'll repeat the process from earlier, where I'm using the script to make all the other element types. I'll refresh the views to make sure everything is created. Great. Now, when I do the same thing for the getSummariesTableValue function, I'm going to have to change the attribute on some of the elements. For the heaters, it's fuel gas flow as the attribute name, so we can keep things the way they are. However, when we look in PSC, we see that for pumps, utility type is motor amps, so we'll need to change the attribute name to motor amps. We'll execute this query, and we'll do the same thing for compressor, this time naming the utility attribute steam flow. Great. We'll refresh the table value functions. We'll check each one to make sure it works. Great. Now we'll build it into the form that we're looking for in the SSRS report. I'll add the plant name, and we'll change this to the view that we just created. We'll execute this and confirm that we have everything in the correct form. Finally, let's add one more static string to the output to show what type of equipment that is. Execute this query and confirm that it shows up. As I mentioned before, in SSRS it's helpful to have everything in one query, so let's create one more view that has all four of these outputs unioned together. I'll right-click on Views, Scripts, Create View, New Query Window, and I'll change this to Utility Usage Report. I'll take this query that I just created for boilers, and I'll union it three times, each time changing the element type. Finally, I'll change all the time steps to be one day so that we can get our daily report. Confirm that this view is created, and we'll execute it once to make sure that everything shows up. Great, we have all the elements across our entire enterprise with their equipment type and their utility total, minimum, maximum, and average across the last day, as well as what plant they're in. And since we'll be doing this in the SSRS report, let's add a where clause for the plant name. Great, here we see the 25 rows that are returned for all the elements at the Houston plant. Here are the 16 elements at Little Rock, the 25 elements at Tucson, and the 25 elements at Wichita. This concludes the video of creating all the custom database objects and queries necessary to use in our packages. In the next videos, we'll build out our SSIS package as well as our SSRS reports, as well as our Microsoft SQL Server Link Server object that we'll use to broker our rights to the data archive.